Start with a quick drink right now to get our speaker more relaxed. Do you like to have a quick shot to make it relax? Or take it out? Okay. Yeah, so we'll get you relaxed.
Is it working? Oh, that's perfect.
Yep. To get you relaxed. So about a round of applause for our speaker. There you go. All right. See, it's still fun. And I think we're all set to start. Okay, false alarm. We'll give him a round of applause again in a few. At least I'm seeing some icons. You know, it's showing up already. All right, we're good. And again, we apologize, sir, for that short technical issue. But you know, hopefully that drink got you all set for this talk. Okay, so without further ado, we'd like to welcome our friends from Cyware, our speaker, Shilu Pushpan.
Thank you.
Kumista.
I don't know what I...
Gising Papa?
Yeah.
Okay. I think it translates to, you guys are still awake, right? I was just having a crash course before I get in. I'm Shilu, I represent Cyware. We're the first company to offer cyber fusion as a service or platform. I get into the details. So my agenda looks very big, but it's not what I'm gonna talk about. So I see a lot of smart hackers. I would assume the best of the breed hackers here. I can see some of them hiding in the hoogas. I would think, you know, like, I'm not a hacker. So I come from the other side, on the defense side. So one of the things I'm probably gonna share is about a customer case, which is a customer of Cyware for the last 3 years. And where we actually, I'm gonna use the use case to see and share how the customer really helped, you know, we helped the customer to fight the infinity war, which is a cyber war, right? And the process, what we did, and I assume it will be beneficial for all of you, and I'm expecting some questions. Don't be shy. You guys are smarter than me. Okay, 300,000 events, not incidents, but this is an actual number. Harvest Bank is a customer. The Bank of Walmart, just to put, like, you know, like it's a big US bank. This is what they see on a daily basis 2 years ago. Maybe this number went up now, right? But humanly, you cannot really defend it, and this is not incident. These are possible incidents. And I think you guys know it better than me, the shift on what the attackers are doing.
Yeah.
Three major things we see. They are much more smarter. They can hold big companies for ransom because they're very smart. The scale is very big now because they can go not just one company, one attacker is now is a campaign, right? It's against multiple locations, geographies. It's really the economical damage is big, and we don't see any slowing down. And with the geopolitical situation, it's only accelerated. Again, what's the importance of threat data, right? So I know a couple of really, smart CISOs I came across. One of them really a coder plus business analyst. He said, security is a data problem. If you have a very good data analyst, I can solve all the security problems. In a way, I kind of agree. But I'm just trying to see why it still cannot be solved. Because the data, but the data is everywhere. Data is with different teams, different tools. And actually, the impact is also different. And you also don't know the importance of each data is different. So it's security data problem, but it's still difficult to solve because it's not one type of data. Right? This is again, what we see from the actually I spoke to at least like a lot of customers. After I'm Cyware, I was trying to sell Cyware product, right? I speak to a lot of big and small companies. I can say a very few companies take threat intel seriously. Very few have a dedicated team. And this problem exists because the data, again, it's a data problem, but the data sits everywhere. Data sits with people who doesn't share. Cross-functionally, internally, a team company doesn't share. These are the numbers from actual assessment by Forrester. You can see it's really half of the companies are not able to share threat data in their organization. So forget about sharing internally. They can't share outside. Because if they can't fix the problem internally, how can they share it outside, right? That's still a problem. And there's no slowdown on how ransomware is coming in. The way they come in is still the same. They manipulate CV, they go, like they are getting better on that, right? And fortunately, they're getting a lot more options to really get in, because CVEs are coming out, 0 days always exist. This is still ongoing thing. And this is also not a surprise to anybody. Phishing is still the biggest one. We have a lot of solutions around phishing, but we still use it as the best mechanism to get in, because there is a weak link, end of the day. Malware is the best way to get in. So these are like, I would assume this is the same problem a lot of customers like ours is seeing. And my whole point of this today's conversation is to share what Avis did 3 years ago and how they transformed their SOC. And I hope that's going to be beneficial for the team here. Okay, so automation is everywhere, right? So everybody talk about automation. You can automate on the system side. You can automate on the network side. You can automate on the security side. So automation is key, but how to automate? How to implement automation? It is the problem, which is why automation really sometimes doesn't result to you what you want, right? So when you really go into an automation, the ROI looks very good in slides. When you really deploy it, you really hit a lot of roadblocks, and you probably end up spending a lot of money, and you get maybe less than 20% of the outcome, right? Which is also not a good investment. So these are from Avis, again, our customer. I would say pretty much standard. Talent shortage, I was reading some report. SOC engineers change job, at least 50% of them change job every year, right? Or they change role or change company, because it's a hard job. You are in a job where you always get beaten up, and you have to really deal with a lot of alerts, which is nonsense, right? And you're doing it repeatedly. I can see someone is smiling. So I think these are standard problem. One thing I really think like to capture is the transaction, because you know, like when you're a bank, the data they need to protect is not just sitting in the data center, the data and the wire, which is very difficult. Like the people are really, and when you, COVID drive all the digitization, so it's become an even more accelerated problem. I would say you guys know it's better than me, so I would just really slip. So automation, how to implement automation? I wouldn't say I have the bulletproof idea to do it, but I can really give you some of the thought process, some of the best practices we really think from this customer perspective, how they bring automation, how they really implement it successfully. Definitely you need to identify what can be automated, where can be implemented. You don't have an option to automate everything. And you also need to really see how can I really do that journey, right? Identify the, I don't like to use the word, but low-hanging fruit, whatever. Start there, but then it's a gradual journey. And again, you should have the capability of automating not just security function. Because if you really look at security, security sits across everything. Security is also configuration. Security is also onboarding an employee or offloading an employee. Like basically security cut across everything in an organization. So you should have a platform which is flexible enough for you to really do automation in every level. And ideally it should be decoupled from everything else. It should not be just security. And you should be able to do prioritizing the playbook or really playing around with the playbook. You should be able to do dynamically adjusting a playbook. You should have a flexible platform which can implement your workflow, current workflow, and on your future workflow or your real-time workflow on really efficient way. And you should have a mechanism to really doing it without losing the control. So you have automation, semi-automation, automation, right? Come to threat intelligence, right? So this is where I was saying, like, everyone talk about automation. Very few talk about threat intelligence. Now you tell me a SOC, you automate all your function, and your attacker changes tactics. You need to go back and change all your playbook. So threat intelligence is like the brain of automation. If you don't have a tied up your automation to threat intelligence, you actually kind of really going to have all your playbook built up, but maybe you need to, you will struggle. You probably need to rewrite them in future, right? So threat intelligence should be the key priority. If you're really bringing a SOC to an automation, I would say you should start really identifying and having a mechanism to identify a threat of that time for my automation. This is still not a priority for most of the organization. Like back to what I was sharing earlier, how many organization, I see very few have a CTI team. It's part of the SOC team, it's nobody. Somebody sitting and sending something, SOC team really throw it in the dustbin because I'm already busy. You give me some IOCs, right? So yeah, I don't have enough time to do it. So it's really, it's disconnected sometime. It's still a problem. And the cost of breach is this million could be higher now, right? Because there are a lot more things happening now. Now, when you take threat intelligence, what is a good intelligence? This is another problem, right? You already have created enough problem on your SIM. You have SIM really correlating things, creating enough noise for you. Now you don't want to bring another thing to create more noise, which is going to really struggle. You're already busy there, right? So this is, again, I'm going to share the slides with you. But I think fundamentally, I wouldn't go through everything. But one important thing, intelligence is always back to a business criticality. So you need to have a mechanism to really say, this intelligence means this to my organization. So you should be able to really transparently, or you should have the mechanism to flag an intelligence with the right business priority. That is a minimum requirement. Rest of them also important because you need to get an accurate intelligence, right? Now, how do you get there? So I spoke to some, sometimes even BFSI. Threat intelligence have a lot of, I would say, confusion. So some say I bought a feed, some say I have a MSSP, he takes care of it. Some say, okay, I'm looking for a tip, right? So basically, this is the threat intelligence maturity life cycle. If you look at it, like if you remember the threat intelligence, the pyramid, this sits at the lowest grade, like, your tactical intelligence, your IOCs. Like for many organizations, IOC is threat intelligence. They get a feed vendor, they're getting the accurate IOC, some brand monitoring, I'm done, right? That's where you start. But you need to really contextualize, not just externally. You need to contextualize it to your internal system, internal business criticality. That's only when you can operationalize it. That's your second level. When you operationalize it, you can actually send that intelligence to the right team to consume, whether it's a SOC team, whether it's a vulnerability management team, or it could be both. Maybe you send to your legal team. You don't know, right? So if you're getting feed, You're just starting. You have to really contextualize to your own environment. Then you should have a mechanism to really send that to the right person to action. And then you may have situation where you actually need to share with somebody who doesn't look at a SOC platform like you. Somebody like maybe in a legal side, HR side, CISO. Maybe he's not looking at things. Or maybe your partner, your third party. But like you look at how many third parties you need to work with. You put a third-party risk monitoring, it's just one portion of it. You're doing a, like quarterly assessment. It's very static. You need to have a mechanism to real-time communicate with these guys from tactical all the way to strategy. For an organization, this journey takes time. So one of the things we can do as an organization from Cyware, so, like our history, our where we come from is creating an inter-sharing platform. But we have built a cyber fusion center, but before that, we were actually the first platform really was able to help organizations share intel globally, global scale. Like ISACs are really our biggest consumer of that, right? So we can actually help an organization start their journey at an operational intelligence level, like somewhere in middle. So you can shorten their life cycle and getting to a strategic level very quickly. So instead of you spend 1 year fine-tuning your intelligence and really creating a program, we can shortcut that and really get them to actionable intel quickly and also really bringing that strategy into that platform or into that mix. Again, I come back to automation. So when I look at security, I would say one of the smartest people are always in security because it's the most changing technology. You take any other technology, you learn it 1 year, it can stand for another 2 years. So some of the technology can stand for a lifetime or few years. Security is one technology, it's keep changing. You need smart people who is actually open to learn, open to challenge themselves. If you give a SOC engineer always same problem, close the same ticket, and give him too much of that, he's going to get either quit his job and look for something else, or he's not going to do his full potential, right? Automation is key. But again, I tie it back to the old story, right? When I'm thinking of automation, the automation need an engine or brain. So if you have a smart engineer, he can bring smart that, you know, he can really pass his smartness to that engine. He can build that enrichments. Whatever his thought process, he can automate. So indirectly, he will really make the engine do his job, and he can actually really look at things more further to really advance his career or advance his skill set. It's from Gartner. I think it's not different from what I said. You basically have the flow. Almost every, like, this is not a single site fit thing, right? If you really look at automation workflow, every organization have their own workflow. You need to work with them, really define it. I would say it is an ever-growing journey in terms of automation. And all these big vendors like Gartner really give you a framework. So you don't really start your journey wrong, or you don't really don't have a plan to really have a completion, right? That's pretty much of it. Okay. So again, for Harvest, what was the benefit of them really moving from a SOC to a Cyber Fusion Center? I don't know how many of you are familiar with the Cyber Fusion Center as a concept. I know everyone knows about XDR, because that's really buzzword. How many of you heard of Cyber Fusion Center? Anyone? No? Yes, okay. So our founder is from Citibank. So Citibank actually built their first Cyber Fusion Center, and their APAC Cyber Fusion Center sits in Singapore. So he got all these ideas from there. But before Cyber Fusion Center, I saw CrowdStrike was presenting the Fusion Center. They talk about intelligence in China. They talk about bringing all the intelligence in China to one place from all the different military units and really collaborating so they can have decision-making quickly done. Cyber Fusion Center come from the same concept. It's actually derived a lot from 9/11. So during the 9/11, US government or the intelligence agency identified there are a lot of information about the attackers, but that was sitting with a lot of different agencies within the US, which was not sharing the information. So they couldn't prevent the attack. So post 9/11, they built fusion centers, where they bring all the different, it's the same thing. I think CrowdStrike went through the same exercise, talking about China. US did it long before that. So our founder, actually, the CISO of Citibank, came from same FBI, he was actually part of Fusion Center. Citi built a commercial Fusion Center. Now Fusion Center is not a new name, because Accenture has their own Fusion Center. Visa has their own Fusion Center. A lot of organizations have. Fundamentally, Fusion Center and SOC, the only difference is Fusion Center has a proactive decision-making capability. They can predict what is coming, because they have a much more better quality intel. They bring the intel in one place, they can make a decision. And they definitely bring in automation. This was the key benefit Harvey scored from our transformation. So they were able to really make a lot better intel sharing. I think, like I was showing earlier, intel sharing is one problem, right? So if you really want to make decision on intel, you need to have accurate intel. So if you really not have accurate intel, you can't really make a full decision. So the intel sharing problem was solved. Then once you have a 360-degree threat visibility, I can do an end-to-end automation. I can really come into the details what end-to-end automation means. And pretty much this means I can have a self-driving SOC. It's possible. I'm not saying people are going to really rely totally on self-driving SOC, but I can give you some statistics from this exercise how they really achieve operationalized SOC, right? So now, these are playbooks. I think I will again skip because this is the standard step. I think I can tell from my conversation, most of you guys are technical. This is a Cyber Fusion, you know, scaled down internally look like, right? So this is done for Avis. So this is not, this is a subset of detection tools they have. They have a lot more, right? So for us, so we have a fusion center module which sits in building. So the first step we did, like, you know, like I was sharing, you need to really know what is happening. First step is onboarding all your detection tools. We can onboard all kind of detection tools, like your SIM, EDR, blah, 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 whatever, right? And then once you onboard the detection tools, you need to have a capability of enriching that with external and internal Intel data. So we have an Intel Exchange platform, which is a tip platform of our side, which can collect, enrich Intel from external. It can actually enrich against the customer's internal data, because we will be connecting their to their asset information, all those information, right? So Cyber Fusion Center, if I break it down, is multiple modules. Fusion Center is a middle piece where you actually manage everything, which connects to everything the customer have, detection and response, and the people and process. So everybody in that organization can log into one portal where they can collaborate. Be it a SOC analyst, be it a threat analyst, be it a vulnerability management team. All can get into one portal. Now, inside that portal, because I integrate all the detection tools, they don't need to log into any of the tools they need to act on. And that platform we built, where we will actually define the workflow automation. Now, the platform will show you the connected view of everything. It can actually also help you really visualize the end-to-end threat. So I'll give you an example, right? If, let's say, the CITICS, which is our TIP equivalent, it's an exchange, we say threat in exchange, it picked up a particular vulnerability or a particular threat, log4j or anything, or anything of that sort. Now, you want to check to see how much of that threat is causing a risk to my organization. So my platform can enrich that information against external source. You know, there's no limit. We can add your free, you know, your commercial enrichment tools, fees, anything, right? So it's actually going to look that information in the external enrichment tool, so you get it enriched against the external sources to confirm, okay, this is bad, this is sold by all these people as bad. Now, I need to see how much that particular threat is applicable to my business environment. So I can again go and check, first before I do that, maybe I want to check if there is somebody manipulated that vulnerability. I can check against my SIM to see if there is already an incident. If there is not an incident, I need to really create a ticket so somebody actively work on it. Same time, if it is a vulnerability manipulated, I want to make sure, check against my system to see any other system have same vulnerability. So I can actually create the whole connected view from a vulnerability or incident to everything connected to it. And since you have a full visibility, you can actually decide the response action automatically. Now, again, this response action I was sharing, this can change because your actor who is coming in is not going to keep same tactics. He can change his tactic. When he changes his tactic, you have a lot of means to pick it up automatically. When you pick it up, you can change your tactics. Let's say you do a lot of pen tests. So you guys do always test the system to see whatever you decided or whatever design is working or not. That knowledge can go back and sit in the CITICS platform. So what we do, like CITICS, you can think of like the brain I was talking about. It keep building the data lake, which is an open structure data lake, which can deliver that information in open structure, like a 6.0 or 2.1. So you can plug it to a SIM, you can plug it to a security device which can read the standard format. You can use the same, share with the team, because we have a capability of sharing it in English or in any language you want, right? Basically, we can manipulate it. So you can send it to a human being, and all of them are really going to collaborate in one place. And when you collaborate, you think, incident manager use NIST framework. My threat hunter doesn't like it, he's using Diamond. And vulnerability management, totally different format. I can support all different type of workflow under the same system. Everybody have their own workflow, their own case management, can create dashboard based on what you want to see. You can create a dashboard which is needed for the SOC team, create a dashboard which is needed for the management. You can even go granularly finding what cost me when an incident happened. So all that flexibility is possible in Fusion Center, right? Right, so, okay, sorry. Am I running out of time? I just want to make sure. I can talk about that. This is what we built, right? And basically, I don't think in the market there is a Fusion Center existing as a platform. What like Accenture, Citibank, everybody did, they go and buy pieces of it. They stitch them together to create a Fusion Center. We offer it as a platform. The benefit is, one, your time to get this running is shortened. Second, the cost of doing is also reduced. Right? I have some animation. I think it's the same thing, like how it is done in a real like scenario. So like Intel come in to the Fusion Center, like I was saying, I have a brain which can process the Intel. Then based on what it finds, we can actually go against and check my assets, my watch list, whatever you save as your historical learning or your recommendation. Again, actually, you can make the decision. Here I'm talking about automatically blocking a 100% guaranteed, maybe a bad IP or URL or hash or whatever, right? That you know, like, and again, this is where I said, scoring your threat intel is important. Like, if you really look at proprietary platform creating their own intel, and they're using their own proprietary scoring, you can't do that, because you want to have openness. Every organization sees threat differently. What priority you put to your threat is different according to the business you run. So we have a platform which brings you visibility. We have a platform which brings you collaboration. We have a platform gives you all your tools which you can define the intel data's priority as you want. Now we can also help you land it where you need to be. Need to be in a firewall, I can land you there. Need to be with the team, I can do it. I can integrate to any ticketing system you have. I can send you a person, not an email, on a bi-directional communication platform, which is why we say we are the only company who can do a Cyber Fusion Center. Now, back to the customer I was talking about, right? So eventually what they got? So they got a lot of plain problem before. Now, I can give them one place to log in and work from everybody in SecOps. They got a single pane of glass, right? Now, I help them create a single data lake. So this is a problem we were talking. Like, everybody log in a different system. Everything have our own data. I don't know how this applies to me, right? Because cross-functionally, they are not communicating. We solve that problem. Because we were able to connect the dots between the threats to the asset and to the action they need to take. So we can create that, and it's all picturistically we can do it, right? So we were able to connect everything. We can pull it so the customer can see what is the relationship. They can decide the response action. And we give them the granularity to executing it. Now, back to the benefit of our customer I'm talking about. This is, again, two years old data, so they could be even better. So Arvis case, this is 1,500 not false positives, real ticket, close by automatically. So they actually put a bot to measure it. So they basically call it RoboSoc engineer. So they want to measure their KPI against it, right? So they can see 1,500 tickets were able to, real tickets were able to close on a monthly basis. And then saving the customer had a really massive number. It's much more than the platform cost they spent. A couple of other interesting things. So they had this problem of fraud management. Like I think almost every bank will have. If your credit card is stolen, it's found in dark web, somebody from the fraud team need to communicate to internal team so they can block that credit card. Right? So we were able to automate the whole process. And nobody need to log in from the SOC engineer to really talk to the fraud. So we saved them time. And I was telling you earlier, automation cannot be just security. Security cut across everything. You think of an organization with 100,000 employees and have 20% of employees are leaving and adding contractor, whatever comes in, right? It's a massive work. So you should be able to have, so they actually use it for, you know, offloading employees, clearing them from the system. And actually, just to share, in region, I did a POC with MSSP in Malaysia. Like, they were doing like massively manual work. They have to really go in, they use a particular SIM vendor where they have issues with the connectors. They need to go and manually check each of the connectors working. There's two engineers who are just doing manually this stuff. I can push all these things to automation, and it's done in minutes, and it's cut across everything. When you look at massive organizations, the complexity is there. When you look at MSSP, their problem is I have a lot of customers doing the same thing. So when you bring automation, these guys actually, one day efficiency goes up because they can do things better consistently. Second, their cost goes down because, you know, almost every software, I'm from Verizon, I spent 6 years in Verizon. Before that I was with Orange. I actually spent most of my life in MSSP. We ranked number one in MSSP for consistently 6 years. We ranked number one in network services for consistently 6 years. The SOC team have no ticketing system. They don't communicate to my network team. I can tell you, the governance cost I put against all my deals are really ridiculous. And it never works because I get a network, the governance guy from a network understanding, he can never speak to a customer on security thing. It's a massive problem. Then I end up putting two people and I put one more guy to manage. This is not uncommon. You speak to almost any MSSP on the round. If they are selling network and security, I can guarantee there will be two ticketing system, two teams, they will never talk to each other. And your networking team will take care of firewall, network, and everything, which is very relevant to a SOC team. SOC team is only looking at SIEM. It's a massive problem. Like, what we're saying is stitching them together. One, everybody get one view. Second, whatever money you're wasting on governance, and again, it's a very manual process, not just money, the time they spend, can be also saved. Okay, so I'm almost done with my slides. I just want to stop, and I actually want to really hear from you guys, you know, because I know you guys are smarter than me. Don't be shy. Ask me questions. I would love to hear what you think about what I present. It doesn't need to be positive. Am I on time?
Yep.
Or I did earlier?
That's okay. Let's get a couple more questions.
Okay.
Okay, any questions from the crowd for Shilu? Anyone who have, comments of used or, you know, are familiar with Cyware, love to, you know, about it.
So if you go to any ISAC, like we serve out of 27 ISAC, 22 of them are our customer, the remaining is working with us. You go to their sites, is all our sites. You put our domain name, you get in. Almost all the ISAC. So they use our platform today. And there's a lot of good stuff they're doing with it. Because what we are really helping to build ISAC is to build a collective network which can be used with the really accurate threat intel information which can action by the customer. No questions?
No questions.
Okay.
I think we're all good. And again, if you know, are just a bit shy, feel free to drop by their booth.
Thank you, guys.
You know, thank you again, Shilu. A very good presentation. Salamat daw.
I think I learned it just before getting in.